sounds like the tick and tick and clack of a skipping rope darting through a pillowy wall of high-pitched voices of little girls. The sounds, they're the click and the click and rattle of a dice game right below his window. He covers his head with a sheet, wrapping himself up. Yo, Jamar, come outside, nigga! He sits up in bed. The crack-stained mirror across from his bed, he stares into it, trying to look past his face. It's hard to make out in the dark, the sunlight crashing into his thick sheet as curtains. He can see, however, that his face is a smashed egg, murky pulp. Welts have ballooned up around his left eye. Purple ooze pushes through brown skin, streaked with cuts and scrapes. He sighs, lifts up off the bed, and nearly falls down. He can barely feel his limbs. He searches for a chair, the only one in the room, and eases into it. Jamar closes his eyes, a warm elegiac sun, a cold, windy beach. The ocean licking at his feet in graceful layers. A blue man and a green woman with painted silver faces appear over the horizon, riding a flying unicorn with rainbow-colored wings, the sun at their backs as if they were bursting out of it. They are naked, scattering petals about the beach, and they hover above him for a second. The woman smiles enormously. The man tilts his head bashfully away from him. They dismount and push closer towards Jamar, firmly grabbing him by the arm and the leg and holding him tightly into their bosom. He is submerged there amidst their petite frames. The blue man whispers something into his ear, lightly licking his lobe. It is a sound of bells and a soft, shimmering cascade in the dark of the blue man's chest with the warmth of the sun and the cool of the breeze on Jamar's naked skin. He can see bursts of light. When he opens his eyes, he's already outside, his clothes on. A slouchy pair of jeans, beat-up Timberland boots, a black tee, and a Philly scout. His open lock. Rom's hunched over a stack of bills, shaking his right hand, and the light from Rom's gold chain almost blinds him. Jamar walks over steadily, shuffling, his heart beating. You. Rom extends his free hand, grabs him, and pulls him into a tight hug. Rom smells of lemons and incense and whiskey, pine trees. Yo, Jamar, bless these. Rom holds out the dice towards him. What? What, you want me to blow on him?
Yeah, man,
damn. The other young men around them laugh lightly in between 40 sips.
I knew
this would happen. Jamar blows in the dice. Ron throws him 7.
Yeah, pay up, bitch ass niggas.
Ron collects his money coolly first. But then guys start hovering. They want to throw more dice, try to win their cash back. Rom snatches up the money and the dice. Yo, chill. Rom puts his hand in his waist where there's an outline of a gun tucked into his pants. After a tense beat, Rom turns to Jamar, a sullen redness in his eyes. Man, change is something. Seems like you haven't. You're still my nigga, though. Oh, I'm sorry, my homie. Jamar just stares at Rom pensively, not noticing that his arms were crossed. His legs spread, his back arched just a tad, his head high. Jamar is standing in front of his old friend like a superhero.
What, you about to take off? The men laugh. Man, you all world now, you all universe. You out there battling robots and shit?
Yeah, I seen you on the TV, man. The short man on the curb says, pointing his brown back bottle of malt liquor at him. Yo, son. That giant robot was like, my man swoop in and bow! Dude was messing him up.
Yeah, that was nice. Another one says, leaning back, pulling on a cigar, handing it to Jamar.
Puffs of marijuana smoke lifts into the morning air. Jamar takes the blunt and inhales it, then passes it back. The effects of the drug does nothing for him or to him. It's all show. Rom is getting restless, almost snarling at all the praise Jamar is getting.
Thought you was a Boy Scout, Rom says, ready to roll the dice.
A police squad car slowly takes by, nearly crawling as they pass the men on the corner, turning a sharp, deliberate left. Let's get out of here. boom, rum commands, grabbing up all the remnants of a dice game. Take two liquor bottles, three baggies, coins, and errant dice. The men drop their stuff into their deep, baggy pants pockets and walk in the opposite direction of the police car. Jamar follows suit. Besides, Rob continues, I know that shit ain't affect you like you live in other heads. Children stop playing in the street. Their eyes train on the young men as the brash gang of puffers, smokers, and hustlers push their way through the neighborhood. I got something that'll mess even you up, man. Who that? A large gray cement door obscured by dead shrubs, by stacks of old rotting tires, overcome with fauna and trash and metal scraps. Yo, who it is? Rom yells back at the door. There's a few seconds before the slow rumble of it sliding open reveals a smoky, hollow room with just little snatches of light. With Jamar or Rom or the short one, he thinks his name is Teddy, and the cool one, he thinks his name is Alvin, and the four of them are sitting on a couch. A woman with a giant afro is standing by the door. She's carrying a gun, but the specs are weird, like something you see at an expo if they had those anymore. Where's Nug? Rom asks, his eyes wide, the face giddy. Just wait here, the woman snaps, never once looking at them. She's clad in all black leather, fits tight on her torso. She's tall, and though elegant, her muscles are taut, worked out, they say. Jamar closes his eyes gently in the faint light. The night before, he danced on an electric ladder. The spiraling, sparkling strand of cosmic DNA residue from a dying god. It hovered there in space like a monument, twisting its coiled dance in and out of nebula. They were only on a routine check of the Z1 galaxy of the T-Rum 2 quadrant when a distress signal burst out of the rock clouds and nearly melted the White Eagle's instruments. It was a sound so bright, so synergistically bright, that it was hot. I am the T-Romulant. I am dying. They extracted the residual noise.